This is a short case of a patient presenting with abdominal distension. If a patient presents with abdominal distension, you should include in your differential diagnosis the famous mnemonic of fetus, flatus, fluid, fat, and feces. So, the patient might be just obese. The patient, if it's a female, the patient might be pregnant. Ascites, intestinal obstruction, masses, all these should include in your differential diagnosis. So then you will proceed with your abdominal examination, and when you do the abdominal examination, you find a positive shifting dullness. You will find when you turn the patient, you will find dullness here and tympani here. You do a fluid thrill and it's also positive, so your diagnosis will be ascites. Okay, what is your differential diagnosis? The examiner tells you, what's your differential diagnosis of ascites? You tell the examiner as like this. This patient has ascites, and this ascites might be a transudate or an exudate. Transudate causes of ascites include liver cirrhosis and right side heart failure and constrictive pericarditis, or diseases leading to hypoproteinemia, and those include nephrotic syndrome and protein losing enteropathy. If this patient has an exudate, the cause might be a malignancy, infection in the peritoneum, or more likely pyogenic or tuberculosis, or pancreatitis. Other causes might include constrictive pericarditis and Magus syndrome, body chiari and lymphatic obstruction, and hypothyroidism. The examiner tells you, okay, you have those differential diagnoses, so what you want to examine else in this patient? You proceed telling that you want to look for the general condition of the patient. Okay, you want to check for the weight of the patient, because it's important in the follow-up of patients with ascites, and if the patient is cachexic or not, which might indicate malignancy. You want to look for stigmata of chronic liver disease. You want to look for xanthelasma, parotid enlargement, jaundice, and gynecomastia, spider nevi, fingernail clubbing, leukonychia, palmar erythema, debuterous contracture, flabbing tremors, the ascites, which is a stigmata of chronic liver disease per se, and splenomegaly, caput medusa, loss of body hair, and testicular atrophy, lower limb edema, and bruises. So, you tell examiner that you want to look for the stigmatic chronic liver disease. After that, you want to check the vital signs of the patient, and if the patient's feverish, you should think that the cause might be infectious, or the patient might enter in complicated spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Don't forget to check the jugular venous pressure for evidence of right side heart failure and possibility of Kussmaul sign by asking the patient to take a deep breath, and the GVP raises, and this is found in constrictive pericarditis. Also, you can examine the heart for evidence of heart failure, and you might auscultate a muffled first heart sound if there is pericarditis or pericardial effusion. Then you want to look for any site of edema other than the ascites, especially lower limb edema. Then you might include a perirectum examination if you suspect malignancy. The examiner tells you what are the investigations you want to order to this patient. Those investigations will include a complete blood count, an erythrocyte sedimentation rate and a C-reactive protein, and a liver function test, okay, because the patient might have a liver cirrhosis, a renal function test, okay, and urine microscopy and microscopy especially for urine protein. Dipstick might be started at first, then a 24-hour urine collection is done if it's positive. Viral serology is essential as a cause of liver cirrhosis, and serum albumin is indicated for further investigations. Ultrasound of the abdomen, chest x-ray, which might show a pleural effusion, which might be associated in 10% of patients with ascites, or might be a part of Meige syndrome, or might be a part of heart failure. Then you want to do a paracentesis, okay, to check the aspirated fluid for macroscopy and microscopic examinations. By gross macroscopic examination, if the fluid is clear, it might indicate that this is a liver cirrhosis, or it's strawberry in color, liver cirrhosis. If the fluid is cloudy, this indicates that this patient might have an infectious ascites. If it's milky white, lymphatic obstruction, and if it's bloody, this might indicate malignancy. Microscopically, first thing, microscopy, culture and sensitivity, Gram staining, and this includes Gram staining and acid-fast bacilli, cytology for malignancy, amylase level for pancreatitis, and protein level for diagnosis, to help in the diagnosis, and glucose and neutrophil count. The interpretation of these include the acid-fast bacilli for tuberculosis, cytology for malignancy, Gram staining to know if there is any associated infection and if there is spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, and amylase for pancreatitis, the protein. Regarding the protein, if the protein content of the aspirated fluid is more than 25 grams per liter and the serum ascites protein level is less than 11 gram per liter, this indicates that it's an exudative ascites. If the protein level in the aspirated fluid is less than 25 gram per liter and the serum ascitic protein ratio is more than 11, equal or more than 11 gram per liter, this is a transudative ascitic fluid. So this is very important. This protein level is very important to help in the diagnosis of the cause of the ascites. Also, a low glucose level might indicate tuberculosis or malignancy. If there is a neutrophil count more than 250 to the power of 10 per gram per liter, this indicates that this patient has spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Now, if this patient has ascites due to chronic liver disease, what does indicate? If a patient with chronic liver disease has an ascites, what that does it mean? It means that this patient is going into decompensation. This patient is going into a decompensated chronic liver disease. What are the other signs of decompensated liver disease? These other signs include two in the face, two on the belly of the patient, and two in the limbs. The patient might be confused, comatose, okay, indicating hepatic encephalopathy, or he might have a foetal hepatic smell. The patient having ascites and caput medulla and lower limb edema. So the signs of decompensated chronic liver disease is foetal hepatic and decreased level of consciousness, ascites and caput medulla, and last but not least, lower limb edema. The examiner tells you what is the management. First thing and first of all, management should include follow-up the patient with his weight and salt restriction, diuretics, which includes spironolactone, but if there is resistance, we give diuretics. If there is still resistance, a paracentesis might be given. The other thing that might be used is transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt in case of resistant ascites. What are the complications of ascites? In general, complication of ascites, if it's very huge, it's a massive ascites, the patient might complain of slight dyspnea and respiratory discomfort. The other complications which are very important is spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, and the exam might tell you what's the most common causative organism is, and your answer should be Escherichia coli, and treatment includes cefotaxime.